come. You'll forever be alone. When you told you you should run away, you'd never find a home. When he told you you were dirty, you should be ashamed. When he told you you could be the one, the grace can never change. Your fire fall, cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love's all I fear. Let your fire fall, cast out all my fear. Let your fire fall, your love's all I fear. Let your fire fall.
Lost in desire, I was drowning in the connection with this service. We're excited to have you joining us. I'm just going to ask if you would do us a huge favor and like it or love it or comment on it or subscribe to our YouTube page or give us a thumbs up, some way of letting us know that you're out there watching us today. That would be a huge, huge blessing to us. Happy Mother's Day to everybody. I know it's going to be sort of odd today with everybody, all their kids cooking the meal for their moms instead of taking them out this year. So hopefully you've got a big juicy steak or a nice big chicken or something like that that you're cooking for your mom. But mothers, we want to say thank you. None of us would be here today if it weren't for you. And so we're just excited to celebrate Mother's Day. Hope that all of the mothers are blessed today. And it'll be a Mother's Day you'll never, ever forget. So we're excited about that. Want to announce to you some things that you may have already heard. One thing that you may have already heard is that we are, yes, doing Vacation Bible School this year. But this year we're going to do it virtually. And so Marissa Ellis and I are working on the plan. And she's got her team of folks together. We're literally going to put together every day's activities for you guys as if your kids were sitting in our church building doing it. And so she'll have packets with all the craft supplies, the game ideas, all of that kind of stuff, the story for the day, all of that. And so we're excited about that. It's going to be sort of a stretch for us. We've never done anything like that before. So we're working hard on that. But the date is going to be June 8th through 12th. So there's 5 days there. It'll start on that Monday, go through that Friday. And every day we'll upload that day's plan or that day's Vacation Bible School for your kids, and so that you as a family can walk through that together. So we're excited about that. I know that Marissa's going to be asking, just, you know, she's already asking for people of who's going to participate, and so we have a better idea of how many kids and things we have to put together. So if you see any emails or things on Facebook with questions like that, please respond, because that's just going to help her out in her planning so much better. So again, we're excited about that. That'll be June 8th through 12th. We are still meeting online right now, but I do believe the time is close at hand that we will be getting back together in some form here at the church. We will, you know, for sure announce that ahead of time and give you all the guidelines and things that we need to do. And I'm sure that you guys will be a great family, a great body of believers that will help us as we continue, as we work towards that process. And as we get into that process, we're probably going to ask you to do some things we've never asked you to do before. But we know that you'd be willing to do that just to help everybody out, keep everybody safe as this COVID thing hopefully gets behind us. And we look forward to the day that we will all get back together under one roof, in one house for a service. It'll be a huge, huge blessing. But just keep your eyes out for those announcements as they come down the pike and some other things that God is working on in the life of our church as well. That'll be exciting, exciting news. Would you pray with me? Father God, today we just thank you for Mother's Day, Lord. We thank you for our moms, Lord, who have literally poured their whole lives into us for every single day of our lives, from the moment of conception, Father, when we were born by your Spirit, to the time that you formed us in the womb and they nurtured us there, to the time that we were born and have been raised. Father, they've read books with us. They've read stories with us. They've played games with us. They've nursed us when we're sick. Father, and many times those things go into us, but today we want our mothers to know that they're loved. Father, we thank you that you gave us mothers. And so, Father, I just pray that today would be a huge, huge blessing to them. Lord, bless this service, bless the music, and bless your word that's coming later. In Jesus' name, amen.
What you say, that you're good. completely to you this morning together. Thank you so much for each and every mother and the sacrifices that they make through the rearing of every child and even grandchildren. Lord, we honor them today and we thank you for them. As the message is brought, it's given, Lord, may our ears be attentive that we might receive your word for us this morning. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Well, again, good morning, and thank you for joining us today online, wherever you may be watching this on whatever device. We just want to say thank you for joining us during this time that we are gathering together online. I do believe the time is approaching when we will be able to get back together under one roof. And have worship together, and so we're excited about that. We'll be coming out with some announcements and timelines and different guidelines, and just so you'll know ahead of time and can prepare your family for what we're going to be able to do in the beginning and then as things progress throughout the summer. Have you ever had one of those mountaintop experiences followed almost immediately by a swift valley of defeat? I've had several of those in my life, different things. I remember one time I was actually interviewing at a church, and when Monica and I left, the pastor said, "The job is yours." And I went home that night, and actually the next day called a realtor about putting my house on the market. I just thought we were moving to Charlotte. This was probably 25 years ago or so. And just never got that phone call. And so I even tried to call back and ask and never heard anything. And come to find out, they'd had one person come in after me, and he's the one who got the job. And so I went from being elated that this was going to be my first youth pastor position to really feeling like a punch in the gut when I found out that they had hired somebody else. Now, it worked out really great because the pastor left that church and about a month or two later. And so that guy got thrown into the fire and actually led that church for a good little bit. And I'm not sure I was ready to do that at that time. So God protected us. But at the time, it felt like a real defeat. It felt like a real punch in the gut. And I was thinking this week about some of those different ones. And I've come up with this one. And I know it's going to be painful for some of us to watch. But I have this video clip that I think will you can identify with. You'll remember when this took place.
It's Barry, who had the hot hand from three in the first half. They're going to have to do something from the outside now. It's Page off balance. Puts it up.
Now, just imagine if you were at my house. We are big Carolina Tar Heel fans. I raised my children to be Tar Heel fans. One time, Austin or Blake asked me, said, what if I got a scholarship to go to Duke? I would say, well, you can go to Duke, but I'm still not sure I'm going to cheer for you. We are huge Tar Heel fans. And so when he hit that jump shot, he had not had a good year. He was supposed to be our star and had really struggled. And then his legs are flying all over the place. He's double pumping a three-pointer, and it goes in. At our house, people jumped off the couch. People were screaming. People were shouting. We were ecstatic. And then this happened.
They go length of the court with Archie Diacono. 3 seconds at midcourt.
Oh, Jenkins
gives it to Jenkins for the championship. Yes!
A real punch in the gut. Can you imagine going from jumping around, high-fiving, screaming, excited, to literally falling on the floor in 4.7 seconds? ABC, years ago, had a TV show called The Wide World of Sports, and their slogan was, "The thrill of victory and the agony of defeat." The reality is most of us don't feel like we need much guidance when it comes to living on the mountaintop, when it comes to living the good life, when it comes to being excited about the good things that God is doing in our lives or things that are happening in our lives. We feel like we've got that taken care of. We know how to do that. But it's when it comes to the valleys of life. And it seems like sometimes the trip from the mountaintop to the valley is swift. It takes your breath away. Sometimes it happens so quickly. Sometimes less than 5 seconds to get from the mountaintop to the valley. And the reality is that most of us need help, need guidance. We really need to understand better how to work through and navigate the valleys of life more than we do the peaks of life. Now, here's some things that we need to know about the valleys of life. I really believe this is what God wants me to share today with us, is how do we live in the valleys of life? How do we make it through, navigate the valleys of life? There's a couple of things that we need to know, that valleys are a part of life. They are a natural part of life. In Deuteronomy chapter 11, it reads this way. It says, "Rather, the land you will soon take over is a land of hills and valleys with plenty of rain. The land that the Lord your God cares for. He watches over it through each season of the year. If you carefully obey the commands I am giving you today, and if you love the Lord your God and serve Him with all your heart and soul, then He will send the rains in their proper seasons, the early and the late rains. So you can bring in your harvest of grain, of new wine, of olive oil, And he will give you lush pastures for your livestock. And for yourselves, you will have all you want to eat. You see, this land that they were going to inherit had hills, mountaintops, peaks, but it also had valleys. And as we read there, really both of them served a purpose in the life of Israel. The hills were going to provide the way for the rains when they came to be funneled down to the valleys, to the proper places, to their fields that they were growing, to their crops that they had planted. And they could navigate that water from the hills to the valleys. One thing I've learned through this COVID crisis that we've had these last 7 weeks is literally how quickly things can change. How quickly things can change, literally, in days, maybe even hours. Our country was literally turned upside down. Doctors' offices were turned upside down. Hospitals were turned upside down. Medical professionals were turned upside down. Churches were turned upside down. Walmart was turned upside down. Literally, in a matter of hours, our country went from a flourishing economy, from a flourishing stock market, from everything being all-time highs, all-time low unemployment, all of that literally in hours was halted and screeched. Even our church. Man, we were growing at a quick pace. We were getting new guests every week. We were having to talk about what are we going to do, our next steps as a church. And literally in just 1 week, all of that came to a screeching halt. We're trying to navigate this time. 1 Peter 4, verse 12 says this, "Dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trials you are going through, as if something strange were happening to you." When we go through the valleys of life, we need to understand that valleys are a part of life. Second thing we need to know is that valleys happen to everyone. No one is immune from valleys. No one goes through all of life and never has to go through a valley. Psalm 34:19 says, "The righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes to the rescue each time." Now, we often don't put those two words in the same sentence. The righteous experience troubles. We don't put those words righteous and trouble in the same sentence too often. But, you know, the reality is that some people believe, in fact, I would say probably most of us believe, that if we live a righteous life, that protects us from troubles. In fact, I know there are some people that might would say, if they're really honest, I live a righteous life not because I love God and not because I'm so grateful for salvation that I have through Jesus, but I live a righteous life so I can avoid trouble. And so it says here, the righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes to the rescue every time. James chapter 1, verses you know very well. "Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing." Again, two words we don't put in the same sentence very often is troubles and joy. But you see that in verse 3, both the troubles have a purpose. And that purpose is to give us our faith, to strengthen our faith, to give us endurance, to help us to grow. And so sometimes we, and you've heard it, and maybe you've even said it, we grow more in the valley than we do on the mountain. And so that just shows us that there. And then finally, Proverbs 27 says, "Don't ever brag about tomorrow, since you don't know what the day will bring forth." It tells us that valleys are very unpredictable. Unpredictable. Less than 5 seconds it took to take a whole group of people who were Tar Heel fans to their knees in anguish and distress. Why? Because we were expecting great news because he'd hit that jump shot, and it turned out to be bad news. the phone rings at home and you're expecting a phone call with some good news on it, and yet once you answer the phone, it's bad news. You get a letter in the mail and you've applied to several colleges, and this is from your number one choice. This is from the place you really want to go. And so you're expecting to have an acceptance letter in there, and yet you open it and you find that you were not accepted. Or you hear a knock on the door and you run to the door expecting, you know, to see some guest or some family or somebody who's come to visit, and you open it and there's an officer there with some bad news. Valleys are very unpredictable. And so if they're going to happen, and if they happen even to the righteous, and if they are very unpredictable, the reality is, well, how do we navigate those? Now, you might be surprised that in the Bible, there are lots of valleys in the Bible that are listed, that are given a name. And you know this from reading the Bible enough, that every name in the Bible is connected to a meaning. Like a baby wasn't just born and the mama just said, he looks like a Sean, let's name him Sean. No, whatever they would name that child had a meaning associated with it. And so there were people who God had said, he's going to be a warrior, so they would give him a name that meant warrior. He's going to be a servant, so they would give him a name that meant servant. He was going to be the Savior, so they gave him a name that meant Savior. Well, the same thing is true with these valleys that we find throughout Scripture, because the name that they are given are directly tied to an event that happened there or a purpose that happened there and so forth. So let's just look through a couple of those real quick. The first one is the Valley of Siddim in Genesis chapter 14. Chapter 14 verse 10 says, "This valley was full of sticky tar pits, and when they tried to run away from the battle, they slipped and fell in the pits." This is the valley of failure. Now, I believe that all of us have been in this valley in our lifetimes, maybe many times, maybe several times. And you know as well as I do that when you've invested your life in something and it fails, you know the pain of that failure. Maybe you've been invested in a team, a sports team, and maybe you were the coach or the player, and you were invested in that team, and it came down to the championship game, much like the Tar Heel game, and you lost. You know the agony of that. You know how that hurts when that takes place. Maybe you've been an entrepreneur and you've had your own business or been a partner in a business, and over time that business just fails. You know the pain of that, because you were invested in it. You had put your life into it. You'd put your energy into it. Your dreams were attached to it. And yet when it failed, you know the pain of that failure. Maybe it's a relationship that you were invested in and it ended, and you know the pain of that failure. The next valley that we find in Scriptures is in the book of Numbers, and it's the valley of Echol. And here's what it says in chapter 13, verse 33. It says, "In our own eyes, we felt as small as grasshoppers next to them. They were afraid." This valley is the valley of fear. They ascertained, getting ready to go into this battle, they ascertained, and they were right. They were small as grasshoppers compared to the other soldiers. The other soldiers, there were more of them. They were better armed than them. They were bigger than them. And everything said, you should be afraid. And they were. Many of us live in that valley of fear. Some of us are afraid of situations and circumstances that are coming our way or coming to us. Some of us are afraid of a diagnosis that we're going to get from the doctor. Some of us are afraid of a relationship and getting involved with someone. Some of us live in that valley of fear. The next valley is the valley of Baca. And can I just tell you that for years I read Scriptures and never heard of this valley until one day a pastor off at a conference preached about it. And so I really came back and dug into that valley. The valley of Baca, we find, is in Psalm chapter 84. And it said, Blessed are those whose strength comes from the Lord. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. That word Baca means weeping. This is the valley of grief. This is those moments in life when you're not crying happy tears. I've been around people and they are crying and they're like, these are happy tears. This isn't that. These are tears of brokenness. These are tears of anguish and pain. These are tears of trial that you're going through. These are tears of sorrow that you're dealing with. These are tears of loss, maybe of a loved one or someone close to you or something like that. These are the tears that a parent sheds when they lose a child. These are the tears a spouse sheds when they lose their spouse. These are the tears that a child would shed when they lose their parent. These aren't tears from losing a basketball game. These are tears of experiencing great loss in our life, the Valley of Baca. And the last valley is probably the most well-known valley. Once I tell you the story, that you may know from the scriptures. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, it's called the Valley of Elah. And it says in verse 3, it said, the Philistines occupied one hill and the Israelites another, with the Valley of Elah between them. Now, this is the valley of conflict. This is the valley that we heard about from our childhood. Now, we heard the story long before we ever heard what the valley was called. This is the story of David and Goliath. And a few years ago, when I went to Israel, one of our stops was at this very valley. And you can literally walk along the creek bed that was there. And I picked up rocks and I brought them home. And they were sort of souvenirs from this valley. But you can stand in the middle of that and you can literally look up this side and you see this sharp cliff. You can look over here and you can see this sharp cliff. I mean, it was a valley. And here's the thing that you know from that story. There were other soldiers there that were bigger than David. There were other soldiers there who would have been faster than David. They were better with their weapons than David. There were soldiers there who were better outfitted with armor than David ever was. In fact, when the king went to put his armor onto David, it was so heavy he couldn't even walk. But David had the Lord on his side. And so we know the story as he went into the valley, as he took a stone and a slingshot, as he hit Goliath square in the head, as he killed him and claimed the victory. So with all of these valleys that are listed in Scripture, and many of them we could tie directly to our lives and things that we experience. I think the question that comes to life is, how do I navigate the valleys of life? Now, the answer to this question, we're going to find in the most popular passage in Scripture. Anybody want to guess what that is? No, it's not John 3:16. John 3:16 is the most popular verse in Scripture, but the most popular passage in Scripture is Psalm 23. Psalm 23, and what I find real interesting about it is, it's the same thing that a lot of athletes will pray before a big game, right? They get together, they huddle up, and they say the Lord's Prayer, but it's also one of the most popular passages used at funeral services. So it's used at those moments when we're excited of great joy and excitement at a game, but it's also used at the same time at those times of great loss and sorrow in our lives. And so Psalm 23 gives 8 different things. Don't panic. We're going to move through them quickly. 8 different things of how God helps us navigate the valleys of life. Psalm 23 in verse 1, it says, the Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. See, God will meet your needs when you're worried. God will meet your needs when you are worried. He is our shepherd. He is our leader. He guides us. He directs us. And so when we get in the valleys of life, you can try to cling to and cling on to a lot of different things. There are people who will try to cling on to counseling. There are people who will try to cling on just to changing moving to a new town. There are people who will try to cling on to a new relationship, a different relationship. All sorts of things when we go through the valley that people try to cling on to. And what we need to realize is that the Lord is the shepherd. And He will guide us, not only guide us, but He will guide us to everything that we need. Verse 2 says this. It says, He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. The second thing we see here is that God will teach you how to relax when you're stressed out. Now, I have to admit, these last 7 weeks, In fact, really the first 2 weeks in particular were very, very stressful for me. Just as the pastor of this church, as a member of our elder board, as we were trying to ascertain what we were going to do, how we were going to accomplish it, once we decided we were going to have to go online and then figure out how do we make that happen with quality, since it was going to be an extended period of time, what are we going to be able to do? And so for several weeks, I've got to be honest with you, I was extremely stressed. If you don't believe me, you can ask Monica, you can ask Austin and Blake, you can ask the dogs at our house. Everybody knew for those couple of weeks, I was really stressed. But one of the things that I have learned over time is to take things nice and slow. And so there were times in the last 7 weeks when others were moving faster than we were. There was time these last 7 weeks when people were making decisions and doing things, and it would be a little bit later for us to make that move and make that transition. And I would even probably say, even in the answering the question of when will we go back, we will probably move slower to that than some other places will. Why? Because when the Lord is my shepherd, He's taught me how to relax. How to relax. The third thing that we see here is that God will replenish your strength when you're empty. Verse 3 says, He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to His name. You know, in the midst of the pandemic, there are many people who are running out of gas. They are running out of steam. They have been going as hard as they can for as long as they can. We know that doctors and nurses and hospital personnel and first responders personnel have worked extra hours and extra shifts and extended shifts. We know that they are running on empty. They are running out of gas. We know that for the last several weeks that parents are running out of gas as they've tried to help their kids navigate online learning. We know that there are kids who are like, I am done. They are out of gas. They are tapping out. They give up. And all the while, we know that there are teachers who are just laughing. Who are just laughing. No, just kidding, just kidding. But we know that in these last 7 weeks, there have been many things that have exasperated us, who have stressed us out. And the key to know that as you navigate those valleys, as you navigate those times when you are stressed, is to realize that God will replenish your strength as you go through the valley. Verse 4 says this. It says, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me. God will walk with you. This is the fourth thing. God will walk with you in your dark and fearful days. The last couple of months have been dark and fearful. In fact, if we could just look at 2020 so far this year, we would say that the beginning of 2020 was a mountaintop. We would say that the first part of this year, everything was booming. Everything was going. Our economy was cooking, our gas prices were coming down, our stock portfolios were going up, new heights every day on the stock market if you're invested in all of that. Unemployment was at the lowest rate. The first part of this year for our country was a mountaintop experience, but how quickly it came to the valley. How quickly all of that got turned upside down. And needless to say, these last 7 weeks have been dark days, fearful days. There have been people who are scared, people who've gotten the virus that are scared of recovery, people who are scared of getting the virus, people who are scared of people who are scared of the virus. Yet God will walk with us. He does not leave us. He does not forsake us. He does not just cut us loose and say, figure it out on your own. He says, I will walk with you. And not only does he say that, but the fifth thing that he says here in verse 4 is that he will protect you in those dark days. He will protect you when you feel insecure. The shepherd carried a rod and a staff for a couple of purposes. It wasn't a walking stick to help them, though they could use it for that. They carried them, one, for help direct the sheep. You know, it's sort of, if I'm trying to herd a bunch of kids and they start veering out this way and this way, he was just trying to keep the sheep in line of headed to the right place. But it was also used as a defense tool, as a way to protect the sheep from animals that might want to attack it. And he says here to us, as his sheep, that he will protect us, that his rod and his staff protects us when we feel insecure. Verse 5 says this. It says, you prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessing. Here's the sixth thing that we read in this verse, and that is that God will publicly show his favor on your life. As he helps you navigate the valleys, as you learn to relax and trust in him, as he shows you his protection and his provision for you as you go through the valley, one of the things that will happen is that God will publicly show his favor on your life. There will be things that will happen in your life, in those valleys, in those dark days, that you will not be able to explain. It's like the person, and I've heard this story so many times, that has one diagnosis from a doctor and sends them for more tests, and they send them for more tests, and by the time they come back to the doctor, whatever he was looking for originally has disappeared. God will find a way to publicly show favor in your life. Sometimes you go through those dark days financially, and then out of nowhere comes a financial blessing into your life. Not something you've earned, not something that comes through your paycheck, but maybe the graciousness of somebody else or the favor, but God will publicly show his favor in your life as you navigate the valleys that are going to come in your life. Verse 6 is the last verse here, and it has two things that it shows us. It says, surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Here's the seventh and the eighth thing. The seventh thing is, God will be good to you no matter what happens. Now, you may not feel like that right at that moment in the valley. I didn't feel real good when I found out that someone else had gotten the job that literally the pastor told me I had. It would have been one thing if he would have just said, hey, we'll call you, we'll let you know. I wouldn't have gotten my hopes up. I wouldn't have called a real estate agent. Monica would not have been talking to where she worked about the fact that we might be leaving. But to get to say you're going to get the job and then to find out we didn't was a punch in the gut. And as I said, God was good to us because he protected us from what could have been a very difficult situation in our life. But at that moment, it didn't feel very good. But as I trust in God and relax in God and put my faith in God, I know that he will take care of me, that he will be good to me no matter what happens. The final thing that we read there is that God will take us to heaven one day. The reality is, on this earth, in this life, anything you face is temporary. Whether it's the mountaintop or it's the valley, it's temporary. It doesn't matter how big the mountaintop is, and it doesn't matter how low the valley is. Everything in this life is temporary. But there is an eternity waiting for each and every one of us. And for those of us who know Jesus Christ, for those of us who've asked forgiveness of our sins and then trusted Him into our lives, there is a place called heaven waiting for us. Our future is guaranteed. I've used this line many times, and some people don't really like it, but if you are a Christian, then anything you face on this earth will be the worst it will ever be in your life. But if you are not a Christian, if you are not a believer, a follower of Christ, then anything that happens on this earth is the very best that will ever happen to you. So the thing that we need to learn as we go through the valleys, which are inevitable, which are coming, and guess what? When this virus is behind us, there will be another valley. In fact, I don't know if you've paid any attention, but there are people who have chronologically charted out all the different pandemics and epidemics and viruses and flus and all these kind of things. And guess what? When this one is taken care of, there will be another. There will be another. So what do we need to remember in the valley? Whatever that valley is, remember first, I'm not alone. I am not alone. God does not set you in a valley and leave you there. For the believer, He is with us on the mountain, but He's also with us in the valley. Remember, God has a purpose for each valley. Just like the hills were to channel the water down for the crops and for the pastures for the Israelites, then He has a purpose for every valley in your life. And sometimes it's hard to see it, especially in the moment of that. But sometimes as you get past the valley, as things change and circumstances change, and you look back at that, you're able to discover the purposes. And then remember that the reward of heaven will last forever. Hosea 2:15 says this, and I'll close. It says, I will transform the valley of trouble into a gateway of hope. I will turn the valley of trouble. How many of us have lived in the valley of trouble? I will turn it into a gateway of hope. Today, regardless of the valley that you're in, it may have nothing to do with the COVID-19 virus. In fact, to you, that's small compared to the valley you see yourself in. Remember, you are not alone. God has a purpose. And your reward will be in heaven forever. Let's pray. Father God, I thank You for Your word. I thank You for Psalm 23. And Lord, it's always an encouragement at funerals and at those times of great loss. Lord, for our loved ones. Father, I thank You for the truth that is in that chapter to us. That Father, the valleys are inevitable. The valleys are coming. They're unpredictable. We don't exactly know all the details when we go into them. But Father, what this teaches us is that You are there with us every step of the way. You will meet every need that we have. You will protect us from every attacker that we may get. Father, You will bless us. You will anoint us. You will favor us. Father, You will take us to heaven one day. So Father, I pray right now for those that are experiencing a valley in their life today. No doubt there are many who are watching this video that are in some sort of valley. Lord, I pray that today that they would stop seeking to grasp onto a different relationship or a different person or different things, but Father, they would seek to grab a hold of You and Your word. And Father, for those that today are living on the mountaintop and this weekend has been a great weekend for them, and Father, I pray that they would just remember that valleys are coming. They're inevitable. They're a part of life. They happen to the righteous and the unrighteous. And Father, they're very unpredictable. Father, I pray that they would set in their minds today their actions and reactions when the valleys come. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you guys for joining us today.
You unravel me with a melody, You surround me with a song of deliverance. from my enemies. Too long my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Oh, 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 oh. Joining us this week. Let's see you next week.